specifically the best detective game, or even more specifically, the best detective game we've ever created. In fact, it steals so much from the form of pulp detective novels of the 20s and 30s that it's actually what I wanted L.A. Noir to be. I don't say this because you spend much of your time investigating crimes or figuring out murders, but rather because it borrows so heavily in terms of plot, theme, characterization, and even narrative delivery from early American private novels. Actually, this game is pretty much what would happen if you picked up a Dashiell Hammett or a Raymond Chandler story and just dropped it in a fantasy setting. But to talk about why this is Brad, I first have to talk a little bit about the history of the detective novel. The detective novel as we understand it was basically born in the 19th century. Before that,
I just got there like 5 minutes ago.
No, I mean today. When did you get in class?
When I'm getting in class.
When did you get in class today?
Probably like at 10:25.
All right. 10:45, you have to get off. Okay. 10:45.
All right.
The police were often are you cool with that?
Yeah.
You good? You good?
Yeah.
Alright, cool.
Now remember, don't put any. What the hell?
Oh, so these are all wires.
No, I mean, what kind of wires are games?
There's no games. The computer was left it on.
This has a lot of work assets.
My bad.
But yeah, so 10:45, you're going on that computer. And you're not going to give Damien any grief about it, alright?
I'm not.
Also, turn it down a little bit. Oh, actually, there's another way you can do it. If you go to FN,
it's not the timeless aristocratic society of England, but the rough and tumble
FN
society of America, where everyone's either on the make or on their way down.
Oh, so
war and flux and the Witcher leaves practically
FN,
every character in
and
the
then you push the sound button.
Witcher 3 specifically goes out of its way to show us advisors,
FN?
And powerful
FN, it's this one here. You hold that down, and then you touch the
crime lords.
Yeah.
And these hard-boiled detective novels begin to focus on a world that really did include the poorer and seedier sides of humanity. Beggars, drunks, and prostitutes appear in these novels. And they weren't just props or real heroes. They were allowed to have real character, a real life within the story. These stories didn't shy away from talking about the real world, from making a social commentary through observation of the real world. These were authors not trying to preach to you, but rather trying to show things as they really were, and have that alone express the problems of the world. We see this in the broadest sweeps of The Witcher, with characters like the Bloody Baron forcing us to stare at domestic abuse, alcoholism, and PTSD, to more minor moments like the Huntsman who makes us look at the horrific consequences of homophobia, as Geralt assumes that people are calling the Huntsman a monster because he's a werewolf or something, when it's actually just because he's gay. The Witcher series may have its history of issues portraying women, but that's another episode altogether, but even with the prostitutes, rather than merely serving as sex objects, you can talk to each of them a bit about their lives, and if you do, you get everything from the prostitute who calls you out for thinking what she's doing is wrong, to the one who hates her life but doesn't feel like she has a choice. And sexuality in general in these hard-boiled novels is moved away from the vaguely implied or often the wholly chaste world to something realer and more raw, something shown and indulged in, but also embraced as human, as something that motivates us, sometimes for the better, sometimes for the worse. Though I will confess, I've yet to read a detective novel with sex on a stuffed unicorn. Then, of course, there's the depiction of Geralt himself, unflappable, sarcastic, taking pride in his work, a guy who can take a beating and give one, all essential traits of our hard-boiled detective. But more than anything, it's the delivery of the piece as a whole that's lifted from hard-boiled fiction. And that's what drew us to do this episode. Because this choice is brilliant. It's what makes The Witcher Wild Hunt. In fact, in many ways, it reveals the key to delivering narrative in an open-world game. You know what? Rather than talk about it myself, I'm just going to read what's probably the most well-known passage from Raymond Chandler's famous essay on the difference between American detective fiction and British detective fiction. This is from The Simple Art of Murder. The emotional basis of the standard detective story was and had always been that murder will out and justice will be done. Its technical basis was the relative insignificance of everything except the final denouement. What led up to that was more or less passage work. The denouement would satisfy everything. The technical basis of the Black Mask type of story, on the other hand, was that the scene outranked the plot, in the sense that a good plot was one which made good scenes. The ideal mystery was one you would read if the end was missing. What do you mean by that last bit? This new type of mystery is one where the scene outranked the plot, in the sense that a good plot was one which made good scenes. The ideal mystery was one you would read if the end was missing. I can't think of a statement more true and more essential to The Witcher. In this, the main storyline, as it so often is in so many pieces of American detective fiction, is simply a thread we follow to get from scene to scene. But it's all the little moments. It's all the disparate scenes that make it compelling. The human interaction with an old woman wanting to get her hand back, or the children in the countryside stealing chickens because they've lost their family. That's what you play The Witcher for. Those moments are what allow us no exit point. They're what allow us to wander our way through quest after quest for hours at a time. It's the journey, not the way everything wraps up in the end. And as game designers, this was the piece they needed. If this had been a more traditional story, and if it all hinged on the denouement, it couldn't work as an open-world game. Understanding open-world storytelling as a series of scenes, and understanding the plot of an open-world game as something that enables the player to encounter incredible scenes, rather than something that directly drives the player down a linear path, that is what allowed CD Projekt Red to present such a vivid world, to make an open-world narrative work. And this scene-based approach works so well for The Witcher because all the other elements of their narrative already come from a scene-based storytelling style, that of the hard-boiled detective novel. So with that, I would just like to end with the words that end The Simple Art of Murder. They describe how to put together a good detective for your mystery, but The Witcher 3 is such a pure distillation of the hard-boiled detective formula that these words written 65 years ago can just as easily
be
used to create this incarnation of chaos. Down these mean streets, a man must go who is not himself mean, who is neither tarnished nor afraid. The detective in this kind of story must be such a man. He is the hero. He's everything. He must be a complete man and a common man, and yet an unusual man. He must be, to use a rather weathered phrase, a man of honor, by instinct, by inevitability, without thought of it, and certainly without saying it. He will take no man's money dishonestly, and no man's insolence without a due and dispassionate revenge. He's a lonely man, and his pride is that you will treat him as a proud man, or be very sorry you ever saw him. He talks as a man of his age talks, that is, with rude wit, a lively sense of the grotesque, a disgust for sham, and a contempt for pettiness. The story is his adventure in search of a hidden truth, and it would be no adventure if it didn't happen to a man fit for adventure. He has a range of awareness that startles you, but it belongs to him by right, because it belongs to the world he lives in. If there were enough like him, I think the world would be a very safe place to live in, and yet not too dull to be worth living in. That is how you build a character. See you next week.
We've got 8 minutes left.
Yeah, and you're keeping that in mind so that you'll have this, not the 15 minutes of play, but
you'll be sitting there.
What?
I think it's watching Terry, but they didn't want to
do that. No, I think so. That means at 10:45, you'll be in this chair.
Let's get back into it.
Well, done saving, done playing at 10:45, which means if it takes you 5 minutes to save, you're going to have this saved at 10:45, and you're going to start saving, I guess, I don't know, at 10:40, if that's what you're meant to do.
I know, when I upload these videos, it's not like it's just the end of the class, though, at 4 o'clock.
So let's look at how we're
going
to
start.
Like, 4 o'clock. Got an opening screen.
You're just actually forced to shut it down.
Alright, 4 o'clock, I'll be shutting it down. But just for now, 10:45. It's 10:38. Keep an eye on the time. You can see it right here.
Then we're going for a car ride.
You got 2 minutes, and it's going to be 10:40.
Now, if I were to ask you what the point of Skyrim was,
I don't want to see Damien have to ask you more than once.
Seriously, more than once? How about more than twice?
I don't want Damien to have to ask you more than once. If I hear Damien have to ask you more than once, I'm just gonna shut it right off.
Seriously?
Yeah, man. It'll be out of his control if he says Devontae down here and it's past 10:45 and he has to ask again. I'm just gonna just like shut it off, man. But once again,
because this is another control game, we're also
10:40.
Which means that our hands are
5 minutes.
So as a player, mechanically, all we're left with is the ability to
chair.
Manipulate the camera.
Off that.
Now, this decision may seem to play directly against the core engagement of the game, exploration. And I'm not sure it was the best route to go, but okay, there are certainly arguments for it. A lack of freedom can be used to cause us to desire freedom even more. Unfortunately, I don't know if that's really what they deliver here. I find it's always useful to look at games in relation to each other. So here's a question for you. Can you think of another game where you're put into a vehicle to be taken to your execution, and all you can do is move the camera while voice actors give you an exposition dump to fill you in on the problem? Yep. Skyrim is straight lifted from Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare, both mechanically and thematically. Even more painful, Modern Warfare does it much, much better. In Modern Warfare, this intro works because it plays much more with the core engagement that they're trying to deliver. In both of these games, the designers are trying to introduce the players to the world you'll be engaged in. After all, this is the only function constraining the player to looking around while you wheel them through the world. But Skyrim and Modern Warfare deliver very different kinds of core engagement. Modern Warfare is attempting to set up a world on the brink, a setting where hard men need to do what needs to be done. It's all about heroic empowerment, making you feel like a badass hero while you run together. It's a gaming experience full of intense firefights and big settings, which this scripted introduction is done perfectly. Skyrim, on the other hand, should be using its time to sell you on this incredible world full of mysteries and wonders for you to explore. Here, let's just side by side these two introductions and look how they show up while they take place in. First, let's look at the most obvious. What's the player seeing around them while they're riding? In Modern Warfare, the player is riding through an unspecified Islamic city, rife with elements that are supposed to feel exotic and foreign to the player.
Sitting good?
But beyond that, the city itself is in chaos. The player passes tanks and cheering crowds, and the impromptu execution of resistance fighters. This is clearly a dangerous and unstable place. Historic things are happening here, and you are caught right in the middle.
It's a bate.
Okay.
Snow, pine trees, there's rocks.
What
okay,
that?
Cool.
More snow.
Kickflip to method.
More snow. Now, I happen to know that Skyrim's full of spectacular vistas and beautiful mountainous landscapes.
I know, you already turned
around. Where are those? Where are the crumbling castles and standing stones? How did you manage to find the least impressive chunk of land in all of Skyrim? That's not how to make a first impression. Of course, part of the problem is the way Skyrim is set up this year. They've made it unduly hard to provide a player with any such visuals. See, you'll notice that in Call of Duty, all the dialogue comes in the form of a voiceover, blending the player from the minaret speakers. Neither of the characters in the car ever actually talk to you, which allows the player to freely look around without feeling like they're missing anything. You'll also notice how the driver and the passenger are seated closely together, so the player can easily see both of them at once and quickly take notice if one of them moves or does something. In Skyrim, on the other hand, the other characters in the cart talk directly to the player, forcing the player to watch them if they want to make sense of the conversation. Not only that, but the speaking characters are spaced widely apart, making it difficult for the player to watch both at once. Meaning more of your time is spent trying to focus on the characters in the cart and not the world around you. Now, let's look at what the characters are saying. In both of these cases, it's a plot dump. They're trying to fill a naive player in on what's going on in this world and set up the overall quest. You'll notice that in Modern Warfare, this is done entirely with terminology we understand. By which I mean, they never reference people by name or even call out specific places. Whereas in Skyrim, within 3 minutes of booting up the game, you will hear the terms Imperial, Stormcloak, Hammerfell, High King, Southern Guard, Ulfred Stormcloak, Nord, Rorikstead, Novella, Kinneret, Akatosh, Divines, General Tullius, Dalmor, Helligan, and Hela. All of this jargon is, I believe, an attempt to make the world feel massive, but anybody who's taken a screenwriting 101 just filter jargon. It all just becomes meaningless words, unless you've gotten them invested enough to try and suss out their meaning, make a concerted effort to explain it. And the more jargon you throw at a person at once, the more likely they are to tune out. Now, you might argue that this was all meant for veteran players to be able to series, to make them feel right at home. But both the marketing and the way Bethesda simplified some of Skyrim's systems, like stats and such, it caused to me that they were going for more mass market appeal. So it's just like an odd choice. This exposition dump is made a little more hand-handed by the voice acting. Now is the time for first impressions, and some of these deliveries sure are helping. I don't know if you've ever seen someone really pray in a moment of fear, but I'm not probably that big of pray.
Alright, time to wrap up.
No, it's not awful by any means. Games have definitely seen worse voice work, but it can be a lot better, especially for a game's first 10 minutes. This is the area where you want everything to shine, voice work included. Now, I can understand why this happens. You can't go throwing your entire voice acting budget at minor characters, and if your intro has a bunch of minor characters, you're very likely to get some lackluster performances in those first 10 minutes. But there are ways to get around it. You can always try to make your opening only include major characters, or you can do what Modern Warfare did.